Dear participants, get ready for the first quiz. And now I will go to my library. What is going to be your task is that you take your smartphones and open the camera. Soon I will activate the quiz. And you will be able to see the QR code. So you should scan the QR code. When you scan the QR code, put your nickname inside. We will wait for the others. Okay, I think we are ready because no more participants here. So we will start. You will have 30 seconds to answer the questions. And we will start in 3, 2, 1. On your screens, on your mobile phone, you will find the symbols and use the symbol that is correct answer. So after vaginal delivery, what is the postpartum hemorrhage diagnosed with which blood loss? Okay, everyone, second to go. Oh, yes, I think Professor Dr. Bulatovic was very clear about this. So more than 500 grams. If you want also to give some comments, Dr. Bulatovic, be free. And you will see who was the fastest, key. So let's go to the second question. When does primary PPH? When does it? Ten seconds left. Wonderful.
Perfect.
Okay.
They obviously listen the lecture.
Yes. And some of you answered 2 to 4 hours. Can we give you a comment?
Well, we can give the comment because I was told you usually primary is defined like from the end of the third stage of the delivery until 24 hours after delivery. I told you that most of the postpartum bleeding are occur in first 4 hours of the delivery, but that is not the definition of the primary postpartum hemorrhage. It is first 24 hours after the
yes,
delivery.
By definition it is 24 yes. hours, but the most probability,
is to occur in first 4 hours.
First 4 hours, thank you. So let's go further. Maria takes first place. Okay. Massive postpartum hemorrhage is defined as, what do you think? Also, let's see. You
we
are
have a problem.
Yeah, bilateral answers. So let's comment again. The correct answer is all of the above. So sudden blood loss more than 2,500 or more than 50% of blood loss in first 3 hours and 5 units of blood. So in fact, you could see on the slide, and this lecture is going to be recorded, this webinar, and we will send you the link so you can recheck and go again through the all the lectures and quizzes.
Yes.
So the correct answers, in fact, all the criteria are criteria for the massive PPH. So Radulescu, congratulations. Now you have to say, is it true or false? Is this the last option for surgical management of PPH? So it's
congratulations.
Yes, congratulations. You also did the both answers in some percentage, but more of you correctly answered. So it is false. What we can see on the slide?
Well, we can see, we say it is one of the options for conservative management, and considering the surgical management, it is even not the possible options, because in the surgical management also we can say that it is delegation of iliac artery and the uterine artery, and there is still some kind of methods which I didn't talk about that, so that is not correct, but ultimate method of the surgical management is to put the uterus out. So to say, to give the indication for the postpartal hysterectomy, and you can perform it subtotal if you're not very surgically skilled, and only if the problems of the bleeding is not for the lower uterine segment. And if you can, and it is always the best solution, to perform total abdominal hysterectomy.
Thank you. So it was compressive sutures,
yes.
B Lynch, that you
yes.
could see on the photo, and the hysterectomy would be the final, surgical
yes.
option. Okay. Few questions more to go. So this is the first and the longest piece. So what can you see in the picture? So it is hematoma, yes, one of the photos you could see in the lecture, and some of you could, yes, thought it is placenta accreta. Sometimes it looks like very similar when you open the uterus and the cavity, but usually we try to keep the placenta in situ,
yes.
intact wall of the uterus to prevent the larger bleeding. So let's go. Sara, well done. Second line uterotonic treatment can be. Most of you did ergometry. In some,
You don't have the same guidelines for everyone, and one should call it that first line or second line. In the NATA recommendation, as you can see on the slides, the second line is the prostaglandins and ergometrin. But we usually gave in our guideline the ergometrin as the first line with the oxytocin, or succeedingly or simultaneously, if patient doesn't have contraindication, and we give prostaglandins as a second line. But medically, everything is true, because you won't hurt your patient or do the wrong time if your guideline consider this as a first or a second line. It is just very important to know the contraindications for the ergometrin, and then we'll escape ergometrin and give the prostaglandins. And you must know the contraindications, because there is recommendation that you never should give together simultaneously combination of the oxytocin and prostaglandin due to the hemodynamic instability.
Yes, yes, of course. But now you know it's one of the questions.
Well, and little help from my side.
You deserved it. So, what would be the contraindication for ergometrin?
The contraindication for ergometrin, it is some serious eclamptic status, because usually when you don't have a lesion on the vessels, like is thrombosis, which is the contraindications, active thrombosis or status after the phlebothrombosis, or some kind of previously diagnosed aneurysmatic vessels in the endocranium or somewhere, then you can give ergometrin even in some mild form of preeclampsia, because what ergometrin do? He does the vasoconstriction of the blood vessels, of the veins. So if you have preeclampsia, supposedly your blood pressure will rise. But your patient have blood pressure 70 with 30 because she's bleeding. So that won't be if you don't have any other options. And this is very good drug because synthetinone cause the tonic contractions, uterus contracts, and then little slightly on contracts, and you must give it continuously if you want to have some kind of answer. But when you give the ergometrine and you have good answer, you will have good tonic contractions for 2 or 3 hours, and it is very, very good.
Yes, and some of the colleagues say that it acts better for the lower uterine segment. Is that true?
Well, I actually can't tell you, is it true or is it not? It contracts very good the whole uterus. And one point is that it's especially good when the cervical, when the cervix is dilated, because then you have good contractions of the lower segment, but prostaglandins are even better for that.
Thank you very much. So let's continue. Again, true or false? This is normal postpartum ultrasound finding or not? It's false. So in the picture that was presented, there is a placental residual tissue inside of the uterine cavity. And final question, maybe you already heard the answer. Concomitant use of oxytocin and prostaglandin is recommended or not? So it is false, it is not recommended because concomitantly, when they are used together, they can be cardiotoxic.
Okay. Well, I tried to help you before 1 minute. Alexandra tried to stop me to don't give you the answer, but
yes.
Okay, you will read it once more. Congratulations.
I hope you had a good time for this piece and stay with us because we are continuing with next lecture just to see who was the first one. Who won the first?